to 2015. It's time for our second quarterfinal of the day, and we have Torlk versus Ersee. And this one's going to be between players that you might not normally see, but both of them have very interesting stuff coming up here. I'm joined by Lothar and Raven, and this time around, it's once again, you're going to be all on the line, single elimination. Raven, did you watch the previous series? Did you
get it was really good. Yeah, it was really close. And also the last two games, when looking at the lineups, Hoy was favored once he got, as he said, the Druid win out of the way, because he could counterpick. But also, like, it was a lot closer than I thought it was, because the Patron beating the Paladin was interesting. You don't normally expect. But yeah, the follow-up as well was just, it was such a good game. But when you see Control Warrior, you just tank up to that much health.
There's
just not much you can actually do.
Yeah.
We saw Orange play through, like, you know, as long as the game as he could, but there's even a point where he's like, is there anything he could have drawn to actually get out of that situation?
Well, I think if he played more aggressively, they were talking about it afterwards, saying that he was just really scared of Brawl, and he just wanted to wait one more turn for his Patron Flood. And he said if he did, you know, maybe he could have actually taken initiative. Mm. Who knows, though? I mean, he had Bash and other stuff, so it's like not even like
he was devastated by the Harrison Jones on 10-5.
Yeah, that
like
was that
yeah,
was
the, true. Yeah,
that was swinging. The turn that made the Patron turn impossible for a while, and that was the turn that swung the game.
And then
around.
The Justicar so early as well. It's not like Justicar came late in the game. You got it so early, you could just start tanking up and make it really safe.
Yeah. Are you okay, man? Your voice is like dead.
Yeah, my voice is gone. I woke up this morning. My voice was just straight down the pan.
Well,
so
you know.
You've been partying really hard.
It's the third day of Hearthstone fast-paced action, so you know.
Yeah, good stuff, man. Well, we have more fast-paced action coming up. We have Torlk representing the French community on Team Millennium, and Ersee, who's
an unknown.
He's wearing an orange shirt.
Now.
Yeah, he recently left Manalite just before I joined.
Oh, really?
And I was just speaking to him, and he said, like, you know, like, he left. I said, are you looking for a new team? Is it something, you know, you really want to get involved in? He said, yeah, definitely. So my answer was, yeah, well, top 8 at DreamHack's pretty good way to go about that.
Yeah, doing it with your own style, too. I mean, Ersee has this OTK Warlock that people... I guess now that everyone knows it, they can play around it, but for the Swiss rounds, it's really hard to, you know, manage your way through. And that's ultimately something that you have to consider. There's decks that might be good for the meta, and then there's decks that might get you some wins but won't win you the tournament. So that's where I'm actually really afraid for Ersee, because now Torlk can come up with a strategy to optimally play against this kind of deck.
Yeah.
Yep. And when you know what type of break your opponent is bringing, you can change the most important aspect of the game, which is mulligan, because you know what you need to be prepared.
Although the other side of it is maybe Torlk plays suboptimally because he's afraid of stuff that isn't actually there. Maybe he's like, well, I'm playing around a combo here. He plays around a combo. That gives Ersee time to play something like Draxxus. You never know.
It's similar to the way you play against Druid, right? Because you always kind of have to play around the combo, so you have to like really focus on your life total at a certain amount. But as you said, like, it's always got to be dangerous. So maybe, as you said, suboptimal plays because he knows it's this deck.
I think Ersee recognizes that this is probably his weakest deck, so he's just going to send it out as a feeler, because I'm looking at it, and against Druid and Hunter, I don't really anticipate it doing particularly well, so if he predicts that his opponent get Paladin, this could be his best chance to actually sneak a game out. So this is a pretty good read, I think, from Ersee.
Especially with the amount of silences he has and the removal this deck packs. My best chance to win against Paladin. The Dark Peddler is also a great card here because it serves multi-purpose and it can be a defensive or aggressive one, so just gain board control and or get an additional mortal coil to just kill, you know, some small drops from the Paladin.
Yeah, and if Torlk actually loses the Paladin in the first game, that's pretty huge, because throughout this whole tournament, we've seen the power of Paladin and the amount that it can just sweep the whole set, and losing it straight away is going to be pretty rough, especially to a bit of a janky deck that, you know, not really the standard at the moment.
Yeah. Lowly Squire seems like the logical choice here, because your deck doesn't rely on having a lot of instant, but Paladin.
Is that patched? We definitely could not see Discovered, like, even as soon as 2 days ago.
Well, it probably was a bug.
Oh, okay. I was like, well, that's pretty cool. Good job.
Blood Imp? Why Blood Imp over Lowly Squire?
So, let's see. What does Blood Imp contribute.
He has stealth, so
is there demon synergy at all?
Well, it is. Mal'Ganis is there, but it might also serve a purpose of comboing like without charge minion.
Yeah, maybe you can play Power of Overwhelming on it so they get guaranteed minion with Shadow Flame.
Yeah, and maybe as well, because he's against Paladin, and naturally because of the hero power and cards like Mustard, chipping away one damage to pick off minions is pretty important. Because you have the tokens available, but if like the trade in, like, you know, one more health might just make that trade a little bit worse, which is just the little edge that might get you ahead.
Here's another thing that's somewhat important. Because Ersee is afraid of Noble Sacrifice, he's not attacking with the Dark Peddler. And with this deck, every point of damage that you can squeeze out from your opponent is pretty relevant. It gets you closer to potentially ending the game just right there and then.
Yep.
With just maybe even one Power of Overwhelming and Arcane Golem.
The Imp's going to do some work.
So the Imp was taken to go to play around Noble Sacrifice, basically.
Yeah.
But is it worth it? Because Lola Square would basically do the same, because it would set up a additional 2-2 minion, and, you know, the Blood Imp.
Yeah, maybe.
Will it be so important this game?
Well, we'll see. I'm actually not opposed to it. I think it might be pretty decent. That's just a really bad turn 1-4.
That's
for
actually just a bad turn.
He's just had really weak turns. Outside that Knife Juggler, he's just been hero powering playing secrets.
So what about Defend of August to actually use the Blood Imp here? Huh.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose like the Void Caller is always a threat, and then there's the Void Caller minion itself's good, but you make your opponent think, oh, can I actually kill this? Because you kind of need to prep yourself to deal with something that's going to come out afterwards. Mm-hmm. But the Argus has more immediate value because you don't have a demon in hand for the Void Caller to call at the moment.
And you have more minions in general on board, but they're weaker to Consecration when your opponent had a kind of awkward hand and didn't have a 4/10/4 play. So you might think of him having a Consecration hand already.
One thing that I believe Ersee is, if he thinks this is Noble Sacrifice, he might think that Avenge is also played. And if Avenge is played, it's going to be really awkward with some of this, the sequencing of attacks. So he chooses not to defend her immediately, just testing out the secret. Sees Noble Sacrifice is not it. And when he attacks here, he's going to see that nothing else triggers. So he knows it's probably Competitive Spirit. And it's not even Repentance. So I think he actually narrowed down to the two secrets specifically, which is Avenge and... Mm-hmm.
Avenge and
Competitive Spirit.
Yep.
Yeah, having to use the Owl now in a 3/5 Peddler
is
really, really rough.
Dude, Peddler gained, that was a lot of stats.
Yeah, and it's still a 2/2, even after the Owl, so still on the board after all those turns. And now Void Caller gets interesting as we've just seen the Owl used.
That Blood Imp choice is really paying off, man.
Yeah, that's true.
It built the board enough, because he's like, well, if he gives me time to build this board, then all of a sudden Blood Imps become relevant.
And he can clear the Avenge minion afterwards too with his Power Overwhelming. Okay, so he can go for the Void Caller and just clear the minions if he wants. Still have the Blood Imp on board.
Unless it's Sacred Trials, but he knows that. He knows
Sacred
the
Sacred Trial would be awesome.
I know. Yeah, then it pulls out the Mal'Ganis.
Yeah.
That's great.
You have a free Blood Imp. It's awesome.
Yeah, I guess so. Well, Ersee's running out of time. He also does, again, have full awareness of what decks are being played here. Sees that it's Avenge. I don't know if he has to use a Power of Overwhelming. He can just also trade with the minions.
You think so? That's cool. Go for it. No, he's using the PO. I think that's the correct choice. Blood Imp might. Just the taunt is more important than the Blood Imp itself.
But what if it buffs the Power of Overwhelming?
It's okay.
It happens.
Clearing the minions off before turn 6, I think Secret Paladin is really important, mm-hmm. because it's so much more manageable when there's just the Noble Sacrifice and the 6-6, well, the Avenge 6-6 to actually deal with.
Yep.
Oh. So if there's Repentance, things like Twilight Drake become much worse.
But you have a Silence, and you can...
But there's coming up a Tyrion, and this game will certainly go the distance where you see Challenger Boom Tyrion. All right, well, I don't know. This is really difficult because you first have to activate the secret, and then you have to deal with the Challenger.
And then Dr. Boom, and then Tyrion.
Wow, actually, he lets him play Tyrion next turn by doing this.
Will he?
Well, because he gives him the mana crystal.
Yeah, I know, but will he do it?
I'm not sure if he will do it. That's a hard question.
Yeah,
I guess it depends on the state of the board after.
Yeah, because it looks like he might get pressured here, and he does have he can pull Morganis with the Void Caller, but Boom's it's better to play Boom I think before Tyrion, but so he might just feel a bit pressured enough. But he's just seen an Arcane Golem, right? So there's a big chunk of this burst. That's the combo luck he's playing.
Yeah, no, he's not going to summon Morganis this turn, which is very interesting. I mean, having Morganis on board already when. Yeah, your opponent has nothing on board.
Yeah, that's a good point. Well, it looks like Dr. Boom will come out here. It's a better play for controlling the state of the board. Plus, it directly challenges Mal'Ganis. 9-7 comes out here, and then you can just kill it with Boom. And I mean, there's also more juice. Like, the Tyrion comes out, and then Challenger most likely won't pull another secret, because it feels like Torlk's drawn and played most of it by now. But it's still a 6-6.
Oh, the big game hunter will be.
Oh my god.
Will be happy this turn. Mal'Ganis into big game hunter, and you still have two owls.
Well, he didn't play the Twilight Drake, so it could have been a 4-6.
Oh, but why would you give another target for the bomb to not hit the
Voidwalker? Yeah, the health loss negates the bomb hit, right? Okay. Or the potential bomb hit. Yeah. This is crazy, because it's like two owls and the BJ.
What an insane turn.
And Shadow Flame.
Dude, that is one of the biggest wins. We're for 7 mana. This is what he summoned. That's way better than Dr. Boom.
But it requires combo on cards, combo in hand, and not just, you know, one card in hand.
Oh, robots at 0.
But the redemption.
This will be interesting to see whether he silences Tyrion and kills it,
yeah,
or actually tries to play around redemption.
Well, he has 2 silences, right? So that's a problem.
He also has only seen 1 redemption, and he's seen 7 secrets now? Or at least, he saw 4 from the Challenger and 2 before, so this is the 7th.
I guess so.
If this is the 7th, then he knows that redemption number 2 is a possibility.
Yeah, I kind of like just going face here. Yeah. Because of the Belcher, and like you're not really afraid of the 6-6, you just may as well not give him the redemption, and it's so much damage.
So this is the 8th
damage
secret.
The place is just like...
You know what?
When you can slap someone for 9 damage, you just do it.
Ironically enough, he also has the second owl anyways.
So even if he didn't get redemption,
he silences again.
It's so safe, and the fact he's on 28 health... And can just life tap forever as well. It just doesn't matter anymore.
Also, Mysterious Challenger doesn't do anything. It's actually going to pull 0 secrets. Unless he plays another one of the secrets that we're not expecting here.
Well, isn't that the second Avenge? No, wait.
It's been there from the first Challenger. Yeah, right. And he played one of the Avenges and the Noble Sacrifice from the hand. So this is...
There's zero secrets left.
And that's 2 Challengers, a Boom and a Tyrion.
And
he's going to win.
That's game. The OTK Warlock wins against Secret Paladin
without any combo. Yeah, without not even close to an OTK.
It wasn't. That was like a Zoo or Handlock approach. Yeah. Just like I'm just gonna control the board and hit you with Mal'Ganis to the face.
He had an Arcane Golem and POs and double silences to maintain board control. Yep. So.
And it's the power of them. I mean, Secret Paladin normally doesn't have good ways to deal with big minions. They don't normally run Equality. They don't normally run BGH. So the fact that the Mal'Ganis was dropped there was actually huge, because it's just so much damage.
I really like the way Ersee navigated those early turns. From picking the Blood Imp to the way he was playing around secrets to even the way he dealt with Mysterious Challenger once it dropped on board with 4 secrets was perfectly sequenced. I think this guy's playing extremely well.
That's true. I would say it was really well played. I wasn't sure about the Blood Imp at all, but it turns out it was pretty damn good.
Yeah. All right. Well, that curve early on for Warlock looks good. And with Fellreaver and other cards available in this deck list, you're going to bet that Torlk's going to want to curve out very aggressively here.
And look at this, though, with Dark Bomb, Coil, and the Zombie Chow. I mean, he's just got all the answers he'll need early on, at least. And, you know, he can actually just tap as well. I mean, he is playing against a more aggressive style druid. But because there's so many, as he said earlier, there's so many answers in this Warlock deck, he can afford to probably tap a couple of turns if required.
Well, he's definitely going to tap at least next turn. Depending on what he draws, he might change it up. Dark Bomb here is a necessity onto that Darnassus Aspirant. Juggler off the top. Good draw, because if you Torlk hero powered, he would give a lot of setup time for the Zombie Chow. And Imp Gang Boss is a great draw for Ersee.
Into Argus as well.
Yeah, and what's cool is that with Imp Gang Boss specifically, you have a unique ability to attack first and then defender, so that you get 2 targets, something that you don't always get in 3 drops.
It's kind of funny to see both players are actually curving out fairly well. It's just because one has more answers than being the aggressive deck as opposed to the more controlling deck. It's it sort of makes Ersee get a little bit more ahead, I'd say. Let's see what comes out of the Raptor now.
Something that is also interesting is that normally the Warlock is assisting the Druid get closer to combo damage stuff, but in this case, and I think Ersee's probably not happy to see the 1-3. That's just statted enough. That's annoying. But it's like he's not tapping either, so he's not getting closer to combo ranges. He's not passing his turn. In fact, he's creating pretty good board tempo. He's basically played Zoo.
Yeah, similar to what we saw last game. I mean, the game ended with the Warlock on 28 health, so there was one life tap.
Well, he has access to PO Shadow Flame, which is a huge deal against Druid minions in general. Not even the Shadow Flame, just the single PO.
What is this?
Wow.
Sludge Belcher off the top. Excellent draw here from Ersee once again.
So you sequence this by attacking first with Defend of Argus just to play around a taunt minion from the Pulse Shredder. Because you would rather... Oh, do you even need to kill that bot? You can just...
Yeah, do you just play Belcher and carry on?
Yeah, if it's a Noia trying to just pass.
Oh, it's
that is not a good drop for Ersee, because then you can't kill it immediately.
But you have to kill the Warbot anyway, because you don't play around swipe in this situation, and you actually will see if there's a swipe in the opponent's hand.
Yep.
He plays around swipe in this situation.
Yeah, I agree with that.
With this play.
And he takes a life lead. This is not generally what's supposed to happen. The aggro druid is supposed to be pressuring
the aggro druid is supposed to do damage to the face, and so far it's done none.
It's actually supposed to be like threatening lethal next turn. That's kind of the pacing of which it usually goes at. And with Power Overwhelming, that is a very clean kill here.
PO into Mortal Coil to not sacrifice anything more than a generated minion from Imp Gang boss is
so
huge board
strong.
Advantage. Another PO to guarantee a good trade next turn.
Wow,
and a peddler.
That's just amazing curving. Now let's see what will be going out of from the discovers.
What?
Flame
he thinks
bad.
He won't be able to combo later.
All right. Well, he's gonna evaluate first. You don't instantly pick it just because it looks good on paper. You have to figure it out. But so I have a hard time imagining that Elven Archer is better tempo.
Would the Elven Archer clear the board with the so you can run the Argus in?
You don't.
I suppose
have
it opens
mana.
Up too. Oh, sorry, he's on the zero mana, isn't he?
Yeah.
Never mind.
Okay, so what Flame Imp does is he actually doesn't have minions to play next turn. And if he has two Power Overwhelmings, an Owl, and a Shadow Flame, maybe that's too situational. So he's not going to get super greedy, and he has a Flame Imp, and he says, you know what? I'm at a comfortable enough health total that I can just pick a minion up. So I can see why. And you know what? The more I think about it, I actually agree.
Second PO will do massive work here. Killing off the second Druid of the Claw, which is amazing for Ersee. Hellfire too.
Nah, Hellfire kills your own board.
I mean, just for the future, it will probably be a finisher.
Wow, Drake's good. Whoa. That's perfect for the Power Overwhelming on curve. And the 4-6 is just annoying enough that it'll be able to withstand a lot of trades with some of these 2-attack creatures, 3-attack creatures.
Well, there's the Keeper to deal 5 damage to the Twilight Drake, but I think there's not enough time to actually do that. This turn has to be Fel Reaver.
Yeah, it's the only way they're going to win, because you've got Fel Reaver and then go for like Silence next turn. Mm-hmm. But the problem is, like, you know there's so many answers. You know there's a BGH in the deck as well.
Sometimes even 2 BGH in the decks. I'm not sure if that's the case, but BGH
is possible.
It's just to keep you safe. And also, you can use it for like cards like Shadow Flame.
But how do you want to win this game if you don't drop a Fel Reaver? Just to threaten a lot of damage. You have the Keeper to silence the Belcher. You might not even silence the Twilight Drake in this situation. Wow. This is kind of off tempo.
Yeah, even if he silences, for example, he's just going to have this Drake trade into whatever.
Mm-hmm. He's not gaining anything here, because most likely Ersee will just replenish the board. And what did achieve with
he
this?
He did draw the BGH as well.
Yeah.
But you're completely right, though. I believe that the Fel Reaver was the right play, because this is defensive. And when you put in the aggro deck on the back foot and actually has to answer the board of the more controlly style, like, how do you ever win? You've got to make like risky plays to actually have any chance of winning the game.
I mean, this board didn't change at all.
It looks exactly the same.
Well, that's going to be pretty much the beginning of the end.
It's okay, he's got a second Fel Reaver after the BGH. Yeah. He's fine, he'll just do it again.
Yeah.
Just wait for the second
also,
one.
He's also going to die. It's like, there's 8 power on problem. Board with the op. There's going to be now.
Mistakes were made!
12 power on board.
Only 3 cards are being burned.
Yeah, I guess you're right. You would just, there's no upside of doing it in that sequence. But all things considered, it's still okay because, is that lethal? I think it is. Yes.
Well, it's 3, 5, 8, 11.
It needs 2 damage from hand.
It's Hellfire for lethal.
Dude, this deck is just doing work for Ersee. And we're talking about maybe it could be the Wink Link, but it survived not only the Paladin, but it's also taken out one of its worst matchups, which is the Druid.
Yeah, the opener from Ersee was insane, though. It was Zombie Child, Dark Bomb, and Mortal Coil.
Like, well, Imp Game Boss into Defender.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah. Then it continued, but just the opening hand was huge.
I just want to notice that the MVPs of this game were POs, because those allowed to trade insignificant
weak minions.
Yes, thank you. Weak minions. I was looking for a substitute word for that.
No worries.
Weak minions for just the big Druid of the Core, which was threatening a lot of health gain for the Druid and just established board control.
Well, here we go. The final boss for Ersee. Can this deck go the 3-0 distance with OTK Warlock? I mean, that's a deck that, again, no one's expecting. They're like,
and he's not even done the combo yet.
He hasn't even used a combo once. He could have played Zoo and it would have been the same thing. He would have just played Mal'Ganis off what we call it. Like, yeah, anyway. Every other game. It's like... Okay, well, I mean, to be fair, the double power of overwhelmings,
silences,
and the silences have been pretty clutch. I mean, you do see that in normal Zoo decks as well, but the whole point is that Ersee has played this control style very well. I think outside of like small little optimization things like burning more Fel Reaver cards, he's been playing perfectly so far, and I really love some of his choices on the Discover stuff, like that Flame Imp. That was something that everyone's like, well, second power or third power overwhelming, that's not great, you know? Yeah. But
so you have no
like
minions to power overwhelming.
Yeah, it's like, well, evaluates his hand, he evaluates what most likely he'll tap into, and the turns, it's like, well, any flame up. I love those small decisions, which are really helping show why people love Discover as a new mechanic.
Yep.
True. And then, but now the Warlock will meet his fate, most likely with Natural Predator, which is Hunter.
And doesn't have Zombie Chow turn one. The difference between having Chow and not having Chow is a very significant dip in health, maybe upwards to 6 to 8 health, because you'd have to tap now instead of controlling.
Yeah, even an Owl would have been okay with this, because Owl in the science is actually pretty good, because Hunter struggles to actually just ping the Owl off, so normally ends up trading one way or the other.
There's the deck with the Hunter's Mark, and those are perfect against the Twilight Drakes that will be coming down from Ersee.
Yeah, basically the equivalent of a silence anyways. And he chooses, instead of playing a Knife Yoga, to go for a hero power, taking it slow. This is
weird.
Is it
because last game we saw that this deck can actually build the board up? And because he has Juggler and Unleash in hand and Hunter's Mark, he's trying to hold off for turn 5 and just try and swing the game that way with Juggler and Unleash with potentially Hunter's Mark on a large minion.
But this puts him in an awkward position when he has to put something on the board when he actually... can't, because now he's pushed to use Quick Shot instead of anything else.
He's just trading, though.
Well, that's weird.
That's well, it's giving more time to the Hunter or to the Warlock player.
But do you have?
But he's like saving one damage for potential of the minion surviving, though.
But it's not more damage. Going forward. It's actually more damage because of juggles. Plus, its juggler would be attacking this turn, so it's 2 damage with the upside of. Being able to do more as it develops on the board.
What I would like to point out is the fact that by keeping on the quick shot here, you're saying specifically that you will not probably play this card until turn 8, because you want to empty on board, because he's being greedy with the quick shot, so he wants the card draw or just to snipe a bigger minion. When having minion on board for hunters, I think more important to just have the constant pressure.
Yeah, the board presence.
Wow. That's a nice draw, having the second Knife Juggler, but he's not going to use Hunter's Mark. He's going to Owl afterwards, so 2 chances. This can get punished pretty badly. Oh,
nope.
Man.
Or you can just snipe it first time.
Yeah. If it didn't, Well, I guess you get the same amount of juggles if you do it the other way.
Oh, this looks like a turn for a Paddler into Shadow Flame.
Does he have? Yeah, he has six mana. You're right. He has the Atvia ability to do it.
Yeah, and this is it's sort of going to get punished a little bit because he has to do it because there's a lot of pressure on the board now. But after all that, leaving nothing on the board and then you just drop high main, he could faceless the high main.
Yeah, but that's a little bit too slow considering that he doesn't have a taunt up by the time he high mains. He's going for a Twilight Drake. Is he going to coin Dark Bomb?
Greedy.
It's greedy, but I mean, this is a really bad matchup, so maybe he feels like I just have to go greedy, and I'm going to try my best. And I think now that Owl's been used, he's thinking, this is probably my best chance to pick up, like, maybe Defender of Argus or something else. Mm-hmm. And then the Twilight Drake does a lot of work, but the Stat Hunter's Mark is such a devastating blow here. Oh, looks like he didn't get the juggle, though. Oh, he did. Never mind. It looked like he was testing. Yeah, some players are so impatient that they're not willing to see the animation.
I do that, to be fair. I just hover over if I can attack the minion and go, okay.
It makes the game more fun. Come on. You get to see the juggle actually go in your life. Because you get salt here 1 second earlier. Why would you want to do that to yourself? Well, you're talking about the faceless, but you just die. So this is what we're talking about. And second high main, but is this...
Well, you have...
Is this enough damage to kill?
We have... Eagerhorn Bow into Quickshot to clear 3, 6, 9, and 11 damage.
So he's put him at 2?
Yep. Definitely put him at 2.
Wait, are you sure? Oh, yeah, because it's one of them's overkilled for sure. Mm-hmm. Okay, well, put him at 2 is good. You definitely know that there's a very low chance, if not none, that he has automatically slipped the Reno Jackson into his deck.
Since these guys have seen the deck lists, he's probably pretty confident about
that. Yeah, Reno Jackson would be great. Right around now.
Yeah, man.
Torlk is, I think, kind of hasty. Maybe being nervous because he quickshotted the little slime instead of Belcher.
Yeah, and took just the
took a little damage.
I mean, this is nothing important in this match, but it might just show us that he is being nervous.
Yeah. And you know what? I mean, if there was enough, mana, I mean, that's a scary amount of damage that was coming out. It'd be 20 damage from the hand with Faceless Manipulator. So it's like, he tries, but this is a terrible matchup. But the good news for Ersee is that he's isolated the Hunter deck, and he can corner it with the Warrior.
But you were right, Lothar, about the sequencing, because one of the problems is, yes, it didn't matter at all, but as a player, you need to condition yourself to just always do the sequencing in the right order. Because if you just go, oh, it doesn't matter this time, do whatever, then you might do that by accident next time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can see
just being too hasty with his decisions, and you need to calm down, think about it, the turns ahead, even though you're playing Hunter.
It's true. I think Ersee also is realizing, that matchup was just... awful. So if I do Peddler Shadow Flame, I just have nothing on board, and I'll be back in this the same area where I'm bad and just dying. So I think that matchup is just not going to be a good winnable one, but he can go ahead and switch gears. So first we just queue up Paladin, see if it just takes a win, maybe even just continue to scout more just to see how he's playing, what kind of stuff he's going for, and you never know. Ultimately you have Warrior to fall back on.
Yeah, and see Torlk as you keep hold of the Shredder, and look at that hand.
Yeah,
it's
Shredder.
Pretty okay.
Shredder's an interesting choice here, considering that, generally speaking, you want to curve out very aggressively, and with the coin, Pilot Shredder counts as a 3-mana minion at best, or turn 3 minion at best. So, I think it's okay, because he's got a turn 1 to 4 now. But Ersee could also have equally, if not more powerful curve. Chooses to toss away the Choose of her champion. Gets a big game hunter. I think he was looking for Mini Bot or Chow.
Probably yes. And he's playing the midrange paladin. But it's not this deck.
Two mana, draw a card.
Trolled.
You can't tell, but my eyebrows are going up and down like a fiend. Flare. Well, that's one way to deal with Secrets Paladin. People always theorize whether or not that's good, but it's not a good juggle because you're going to trade it anyways.
Yep. And then now the Peacekeeper will probably do some work.
Yes, unless you feel greedy enough to play the Master Battle into a
yeah.
If you don't have consecration, that's not the way to do it.
Yep.
You can bait out the Unleash the Hounds next turn if you have the consecration. Might have actually been even like a kinda risky, but not worth it. But in this situation, Peacekeeper seems to be the best option.
Yeah, and especially because you have the Quartermaster in hand, right? So saving muster for a bit later isn't bad because you know you can potentially pull off the Quartermaster if there's no Unleash.
The only better situation would be the quick shot or a figure combo, of course, but you can't play around that. I mean, imagine if you go Masterful Battle, you attack into the Knife Juggle, just put it on 1 HP so you can kill it, even though your opponent will have Unleashed the Hounds. But yeah, it's like, that's so risky. 1 Unleashed the Hounds just seals the game here.
Yeah, I don't think you need to take an unnecessary risk here. Although, you know, are you keeping Unleashed the Hounds in your hand?
Against Paladin?
Yeah,
Paladin.
Of course. Yeah.
Like when, I mean, if you have a good curve and you can just keep at turn 3, you know, Unleashed the Hounds is, I think, is amazing.
Okay. Well, he's got another sticky minion with the Pilot Shredder, but you know that might not matter. Hunter might just ignore it, play their own minion. Oh, he's
trading.
Okay.
I think because the juggler is so important, he wants to just see if he can actually keep the juggler alive.
He will swing a minion with 1 damage.
Yeah, that fallen hero surviving is a pretty annoying thing for the hunter. Because it challenges the Shredder directly. Also, we have a pretty powerful turn 5 play with some knife juggles and muster for battle.
But you first attack with the... Oh, wait, you can actually attack with the Fallen Hero to Palta Shredder and then play knife juggle into muster battle, and that's probably the best turn.
Yeah. Yes.
Because the problem is, although the minion does challenge the Shredder, well, the Shredder drops and the juggler throws a knife, and the juggler's still alive. And it's still not going anywhere. So, you know, he can still snipe down all the 1-1s. So he kind of needs the juggles to just kill the juggler. And if not, again, there's threat of air, Unleash the Hounds.
Exactly. So you play first Knife Juggler, then trade, and then go into Master for Battle.
Put this
apple on your head. Oh. Good sequencing from Ersee. Oh, okay.
He's going to try the juggles first.
So he's not trading with...
Oh, wow.
This stops the...
What? That was perfect.
Wow.
Still
and the
kind
tot
of,
for
still,
the Annoying
still
Tron.
Kind of perfect. I mean, just like, well, I have a 1 damage Divine Shield, and he can't challenge the juggler. And he's forced instead to Eagle Horn Bow instead of play on curve for anything else. He's so afraid of that knife juggler. But guess what comes after this?
Quartermaster. This will be painful for
Torlk. The classic QM into the BM. That's what I was taught yesterday. It's the worst feeling. Someone said, I forgot who told me that, but it was like QM. And they're like, oh, the Quartermaster. And then you get to kill his Annoyatron, and you have a lot of pressure coming the other way. Hymen doesn't matter. He's going to temple you out of the game. What has happened here?
No, you have to go with the 7 of Hymen. It's the biggest drop.
Oh, gosh.
You killed one of the 1-1s who was being transported into Super Saiyan.
And Belcher. Oh. Belcher is going to just take the hit here, acting kind of like...
the game ender.
The game ender. That might as well have been Tyrion. Because it's like you're it's like, how are you getting past it? It's like there's too many things that go past. That is one way to defend yourself.
But then is Big Game Huntered? And
oh,
GG.
You're right. What if you Animal Companion and taunt that?
So you can get a Misha too.
Yeah, or even Leox, okay, because you just want the most health, right?
Yep, just not Huffer.
Huffer.
I said just not Huffer.
It's always Huffer, man.
Well, crap. It's not exactly what you want to see. You can kill the Belcher, which almost certainly you will. There's no way to play around that. And you Houndmaster the highest health, which is the High Man. That's it.
I mean, Huffer would just be a schnitzel for the Belchers. So.
Schnitzel? I would like to try Huffer Schnitzel. I think he's killed me enough times where I wouldn't mind tasting it myself. All right, here we go. He tries his best to put up the most health, but, I mean, he's literally got the beast in his sights. I think that's the first time that I've heard that line correctly used.
Bam.
That's it. Game over. Ersee goes to the semifinals with two wins from his OTK Warlock. Well played. And Torlk immediately goes for the handshake and good sportsmanship.
Yeah.
So it's like, yeah, I recognized, man, you won. You got me. And it wasn't even necessarily close. It was a 3-1 with one matchup going the Hunter's way, which it should win.
Yeah, and with a really interesting Warlock deck as well, because I'm pretty sure he's probably the only person who's brought that deck.
Yeah.
And the fact that you can make it work without relying on like a single combo, it's like the deck has multiple win conditions. So that's it's nice to see him pilot and not just heavily rely on trying to draw into the Golem.
That's how the deck should look in Hearthstone in general, to have multiple win conditions to get like get the best out of two wards.
All right, well, we're joined currently by Ersee, who is our second semi-finalist. So, man, good job, dude. I don't think first of all, were you expecting to get two wins out of the OCK Warlock? Because it felt like you were just sending it out as like a feeler deck because maybe it wouldn't work out as good compared to some of your other decks, but it ended up grabbing two important wins.
So you're asking why I picked it first?
Yes.
I was actually expecting him to start Hunter. He has been starting a lot of Hunter, I think. That was what I've been told anyways. And I just didn't want to start with Warrior because of this, so it was a flip between Warlock and Paladin. And I really wanted to save the Paladin for
his Druid.
His Druid, because I feel like mid-range Paladin just counters that archetype completely.
Okay. So you wanted Hunter versus Warlock?
Basically, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Basically, yeah.
Interesting. I thought you felt like it was weak, so you kind of wanted to avoid that. But
It's all right. It's not as bad as it looks, because I drew very poorly in the Hunter matchup. If I get the Zombie Chow opening...
Yeah. We're just like, the
difference. I had an opening that was like Zombie Chow, Dart Bomb, Coil on one of the matches. Yeah, like if you had that versus Hunter...
I had an insane start with the OTK Warlock. And well, I wouldn't call it an OTK Warlock. It's just, it's more like a mid-range Warlock with...
That has combo.
That has a finishing, kind of like Combo Druid. Like you just push out threats. You don't wait and then kill them. You just push out threats and then once they can't deal with a minion, then you just win.
Sure. That's the cool way to put spin on it. It's just a mid-range Warlock. I guess maybe we should stop calling it OTK. It just happened to have a
it's
big damage.
It has a combo. You can call it combo Warlock, I guess.
Yeah, combo Warlock. All right. Well, you got really big wins here. I mean, did you expect to go that way specifically, though? I mean, because you got the win against the Paladin, and I wasn't expecting it to grab those first two wins specifically.
Well, I think the matchup against Paladin is actually better than anyone thinks. I think it's a really good matchup.
Spoken like a true Warlock specialist. Like, well, I made the deck. It's great. It's favored against everything.
It will win everything.
You sound like a rogue player right now.
Exactly
you
are. Every rogue player is like, rogue is good against this, and this.
It's not great, but you can't totally counter Secret Paladin, right? You can't. There is no great deck against it. But it's over 50%, and that's good enough for me. And if he has Divine Favor, it's really terrible. But we know the decklist. We were sent the decklist, so I know he didn't have it, and I was pretty confident sending Warlock into that as well.
I believe you're advancing in the bracket up against Hoi, because you're in the top half. Yes, I believe so.
Okay.
So how do you feel against Hoi, your chances are, compared to Torlk, who you just... It seemed pretty one-sided the way you beat him.
Yeah, Hoi has a more difficult lineup for me, so I expect it to be much more difficult.
Okay, cool.
And this is probably going to be my toughest match so far, and Hoi's been crushing everybody, so based on his decks and his performance, it's gonna be a tough match.
Statistically, it's more might be a common situation to him to lose now, because how much can you win?
Yeah,
right.
A lot, apparently. He's in the I think he's in the 90s right now, right? With how often he's been winning, but it's pretty nuts. The last thing we do want to say is I want to commend you for the Blood Imp pick. That was really cool, man. The way you're able to utilize that very effectively for board control, recognizing your hand.
Yeah,
stuff. That was really
cool.
Lowly Squire.
Lowly Squire and Blood Imp. And what was the third one? Something.
The third one was
like
it's
like Elven Archer. Or
So 1-2 is generally good against Paladin, but playing it onto an empty board after that is not so good. And Blood Imp is just something that will stick. And since I had Argus, it's somehow going to combo.
Yeah,
so
well, we saw the silence onto the Dark Peddler, and then it still didn't get answered. The Dark Peddler was like a 3-5 or something.
Yeah.
And then
had
to get
like,
silenced.
Oh my
it's
god,
like,
this is brilliant.
Yeah.
Really nicely done, really nicely done. Anyways, anything you want to say finally before we let you go?
I have not much more to say. I'm just looking forward to my next game. That's what's on my mind right now. I'm here to play Hearthstone, and that's it.
Awesome, man. Well, the next up-and-coming Finnish player that you should watch out for is Ersee, man. He's playing extremely well. We'll see how far he goes against Hoi. But before we do that, we are halfway done through our quarterfinals. Coming up next, we have Purple versus AKA Wonder. So don't go anywhere, guys. We're going to go straight into matches. It's the final day here at the DreamHack Grand Prix, so stay tuned.